فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحوم كالطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We can try again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. My beloved children, wallahi, you know the best of stories in the Quran. Allah says, "Nahnu naqussu 'alayka ahsana al-qasasi bima awhayna ilayka hadha al-Qur'an." Which story is that? Which story is that? Yes. The story of the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. MashaAllah, MashaAllah, MashaAllah. So Allah has mentioned a beautiful story. Who knows the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam a little bit? Put up your hand. That is almost all of us. Put your hands down. It is very interesting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a story to us. But do you think that Allah writes a story, or Allah has written or said or sent down that story in the Quran without a reason? Do you think there is no purpose for it, or there is a reason? There is a reason. So what is the reason? Who can tell me? Put up your hand. What is the reason that that story is in the Quran? Yes, in the front here. Yes. What is the reason? Okay, someone else also? Another one? Yes? Yes?
One of his prophets.
But who knows? Yes, the sister here, the one of my daughters here. The, yes?
To learn.
Very, very good. I like that answer, to learn.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
Indeed, in the stories of the previous prophets, there are lessons for those who have sound intellect, those who have a sound mind. Are you following what I'm saying? Those who have a sound mind. So what are the lessons we learn from the story of Yusuf alayhi salam? Let us start off with the first lesson. The son saw a strange dream. Am I right? He saw a dream of 11 stars, the sun and the moon, prostrate to him. He was very, very surprised by this dream. And what he did is, he chose to say the dream to his best friend. Who was his best friend?
His father.
Whoa. That teaches us that we need to keep our parents very close to us. If you have issues, the first person you discuss the issue with is your parents, your father, your mother. Is that a lesson? It's a lesson we learn. You need to tell your mom and your dad today that we learned that we are supposed to be so close to you, and you are supposed to be close to us, that if anything interesting, surprising, amazing, shocking, saddening happens in our lives, we should be talking to you. We should be relating it to you. So when he told his father the dream, did the father get angry? Hey, stop wasting my time. Move away. Is that what the father said?
No.
The father says, Oh my son, be careful of jealousy. Be careful of what? When something nice happens to you, sometimes people become jealous because shaitan works on them. People are good, but shaitan is
bad.
People are good, but shaitan is
bad.
So your brothers, your sisters, your friends, your uncles, your aunts, the people around you, Muslim, non-Muslim, the people are good, but shaitan is the one who is
bad.
Bad, subhanallah. Now, if you look at this, the father says, he was a Nabi of Allah, his name was Ya'qub alayhi salam, isn't it? Who can tell me another name of Ya'qub? Another name of Ya'qub alayhi salam. He had another name, he was known by something else. What was it? Yes, stand up and say it loudly.
Israel.
10 out of 10, mashallah. Mashallah, tabarakallah. May Allah bless you. His name was also Israel. So this Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam, being a prophet of Allah, he knew that this dream means something really great. It means something grand.
It means something very big. It has a meaning that is really great. So I don't want this child to tell even his own brothers. Because sometimes your brothers can become jealous of you. Your sisters can become jealous of you. Not all the time, but sometimes it can happen. So be careful. When you are jealous of someone, you are the one who will lose. I want to fast forward the story. You see, the brothers were jealous. They tried to harm their brother because he was a young boy. You know, when your mother says, "Don't tell anyone," you say, "Okay." Then what do you do? You tell someone and what is the password? You see, if I tell you, "Please don't tell someone," and I give you, then you say, "Okay, I won't tell anyone." You quickly run to Abdullahi and you tell him, "Listen, I want to tell you something, but don't tell anyone." And then you say it to Abdullah. And Abdullah runs to Maryam and says, "Maryam, you know what? I want to tell you something, but don't tell anyone." And Maryam runs to Khadija what does she say? She says, "I want to tell you something, but..." So what is the password? Don't tell anyone. That's a password. But as Muslims, that's not supposed to be the case. When you are told, "Don't tell anyone," do not tell anyone. It's over. So the young boy was so excited, he went to his brothers, he says, "Hey, guess what, I tell you something. Yeah, this is the case," okay? The brothers became jealous of him. And the brothers decided that they wanted to harm him. Some said, "Let us kill him," astaghfirullah. Very bad thoughts, but those thoughts were from shaitan. Those thoughts were from?
Shaitan.
However, right at the end, who was the winner and who was the loser? Was it Yusuf who won or the jealous brothers? Yusuf alayhi. Those who were jealous, they were the ones who lost. So if you develop jealousy for someone, you will become lower than them. Did you hear that? If you develop jealousy for someone, you will become? You better be writing these points because I'm going to ask you at the end. There will be a Q&A. Subhanallah. If you develop jealousy for someone, you will become lower than them. And I want to give you the second example. The first was Yusuf alayhi salam's jealous brothers. They were lower than him at the end. Although at the beginning, they thought that they were above, they were bigger, they were stronger, they were older. But that jealousy made them lower than him in the long run. Secondly, Adam alayhi salam was created by Allah as the first of the creatures of humankind, right? And Allah told the angels to prostrate, all of them prostrated besides one who was jinn, and he was Iblis. Iblis was the head of the shayateen, the top shaytan that there was. What did Iblis say? He says, "Ana khayrun minhu, khalaqtani min narin wa khalaqtahu min teen." I am better than him. You created me from fire and him you made him from soil or dust or sand. I'm better. Iblis became jealous of Adam alayhi salam. As a result, the jealousy made him be dropped lower than Adam alayhi salam. Do you see? It's another example. The brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam, when they were jealous, they were dropped lower than Yusuf alayhi salam. Iblis, when he was jealous, he was dropped lower than Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. So if we are ever those who develop jealousy, you see someone with a nice car, a nice pen, someone comes first in class, someone, for example, has nice clothing, a nice watch, a nice phone, a nice something, you must just say, "MashaAllah, Tabarakallah, Alhamdulillah, I'm happy." And you continue. You might not have a phone, you might not have such a car, you might not have so much of money, pocket money, you might not be able to afford that type of food. It's okay, for as long as you are alive, you are breathing, you are healthy, Allah has blessed you with so much, you have your nose, you can see and so on. Imagine those who cannot see. May Allah grant them good eyesight. Say Ameen. May Allah restore the eyesight of those who are blind. Say Ameen. Imagine those who are struggling because they cannot sleep because of war and famine and so on and so forth. Allah has blessed us. Allah has blessed us so much. Thank Allah. Thank Allah. Whatever He gave you, He chose it for you, your parents and whoever else. Some of us don't have parents, so someone else is looking after us. At least there is someone looking after us, right? Subhanallah. So thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the brothers, they planned the downfall of their own brother. So they decided to take him and they went, they told the father, "We are going to play with him. We will come back. no problem, and we will bring him, he will come and play with us, we will race and whatnot. And they did not bring him back because they threw him into a pit. They threw him into a pit. In one narration it was like a well, like a well. They just threw him in, they closed it and they ran away. Imagine what type of bad deed they did. But I want to give you good news. Think for a moment, if someone took you and put you in a place like a pit or a well and covered it and went away and there was just silence, what would you do? Would you start crying, "Mommy, mommy"? Would you start crying? No, you start remembering Allah. "Oh Allah, help me. Oh Allah, I know I'm in a dark place. I know that what has happened to me is bad. I seek your help." So what I want you to write down: when you are struggling, seek the help of Allah. When you are struggling, seek the help of Allah. When you go through a very, very sad moment, seek the help of Allah. Continue seeking the help of Allah, and Allah will help you. Continue seeking the help of Allah, Allah will help you. Look at this man, young boy, he's in a pit, dark place. He continued to call out to Allah. And what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent help for him after some time. People came, they saw this well, it was a dry well, and they decided, "We want to put our bucket down," and they put the bucket going all the way down because they were travelers. You know, when you are traveling and you stop at a place to refuel, sometimes you want to drink water, etc. And so you go, sometimes there is a kiosk, sometimes there are people selling water on the side, sometimes there is a tap. So you go to the tap to make your wudu or whatever reason you want the water for. And what happens? You turn it on, you expect water. Alhamdulillah. We are so lucky, we don't even have to struggle so much in most cases. But there are people right now in the rural areas, what do? For water, they have to walk, they go with their buckets, they fill it in the river, they come back. Am I right? Yes. So thank Allah. Allah has blessed us. Say Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. I didn't hear that loud enough. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah.
MashaAllah. Tabarakallah. So, when they went, and as they lifted their bucket, they found there was a boy clinging onto the bucket. And he must have seen this bucket. Oh, subhanAllah, the help of Allah has come. He held onto the bucket. They pulled it up. It was very heavy. And they saw, قَالَ يَا بُشْرَى هَذَا غُلَامٌ. They said, "Oh, good news. This is a young boy." But now there was a problem. What was the problem? When they saw a young boy, very wrongly, they decided, let's make money by selling this boy. Let's make money by selling this boy. Astaghfirullah. May Allah protect all of us. Say Ameen. They sold him in the market. When he went there was double trouble. More trouble. They sold him in the market as a slave. Yet he was a free man, free boy. But look, sometimes when bad things happen to you, you need to know if you bear patience, the ending will be better. The ending will be better. Maybe you might fail one exam, but you will pass another one and another one. Maybe you might miss one flight, but you will catch another one. Allah will save you from something. You might not be able to attend a function today. Maybe something bad was going to happen there, or maybe Allah saved you from something. So sometimes, when something bad happens to us, we need to be convinced that if we have iman, the end result will be much better. Look at what happened to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. After a while, they sold him. Now, they sold him and he started working. When he was working, some people started accusing him of all sorts of crimes, all sorts of things. After a while, they jailed him. They put him into the jail. So, problem after problem after problem. But who was he? He was the Nabi of Allah. His father was a Nabi. His grandfather was a Nabi. His great-grandfather was a Nabi. He was the most fortunate. Imagine, you are a son of a chief. And the chief is a son of another chief who was a son of a chief who was a son of a chief. You will be the most important person in Nigeria. Do you agree? Yes. Look at the people nodding their heads. Maybe some of you might be the children of chiefs. Is that correct? Possible. Oh, I heard yes. MashaAllah. I'm fortunate to be here. Alhamdulillah. So, the point I want to raise is that Yusuf alayhi salam was loved by Allah, no doubt. I want you to write that down. A sign of the love of Allah is that He tests you. He tests you. A sign of the love of Allah is that He tests you all the time. He will test you more and more. إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا ابْتَلَاهُ. When Allah loves a worshipper, He tests him more. Another point you could also write down is, when Allah has tested you again and again, it does not mean He is upset with you. When Allah has tested you again and again, it does not mean that He is upset with you. It does not mean He is upset with you. Okay, so now we look at Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. He had one issue, the brothers became jealous. After that, they wanted to kill him. After that planning of killing, they decided we will abandon him. When they abandoned him, someone brought him up but sold him. When they sold him, he had to work as a slave. After he was working as a slave, they accused him. After the accusation, he was jailed. One after the other. Anyone here would think that, hey, what is going on? My life is a mess. My life is a mess. Everything is going wrong. No, my son. No, my daughter. Your life is not a mess. 10 things can go wrong. After that, Allah will open your doors. Be patient. I counted so many things that, according to us, may have gone wrong in the life of Yusuf alayhi salam. But this was the plan of Allah for His most beloved. Yusuf alayhi salam, in his own right, was also a Nabi. He was a prophet of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You follow? So now, as Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam emerged from the jail, In fact, let me talk about why he was in the jail. They jailed him. He didn't even know when he was going to come out. He was in jail, but he was innocent. This also means sometimes when you are jailed, you might not be guilty of what you are being accused of. It's possible. It has happened times where sometimes people accuse you of something and you are not the one who's guilty of that particular sin. So it can happen. People lay false accusations. Don't believe everything you hear about someone that is bad. If it's good, believe it. If it is bad, don't believe it. Did you hear that? If someone says, this man is very good, this sister is very good, believe it. If someone says, this person is very bad, they need to bring proper evidence. And if it is not affecting me, I don't even need to entertain it and I don't need to believe it. Nowadays they have Photoshop. They can Photoshop you doing anything that you did not do. Am I right? They also have video shop. Have you seen video shops? They can video you doing something you did not do. I want to ask you a question. How many of you have watched movies? Don't be shy. Be honest. Put up your hand. Right. Put your hands down. Do you see people dying in the movies? Have they died in real life? So then, when you look at the movie, you even begin to cry sometimes. You think, oh, my hero is dead. My hero is dead. Right? You begin to cry. But in real life, that person did not die. They were not harmed. They were not injured. They are enjoying a life. They were only acting. They were only acting. And there are some camera tricks that they use to show you that we are moving fast. We are turning here. We are doing that. We are flying on a plane. Wallahi, they are flying on no plane. They are just in a room which looks like a plane. And then the camera is just moving to make you think like the plane is moving. And we are busy watching. This aircraft, yeah, it's cruising. So sometimes you have things that are there that are not a reality. So this is why I say, don't believe everything you hear or even see. Before, we used to say seeing is believing. Nowadays we say it depends what you are seeing. If it's a video, it's not necessarily believing. Do you understand? They can make a video, like I gave you the example of a movie. These movies, they are just acting. You know, there is a lot of ketchup that is used and we think it's blood. You see the blood splat, go and dip your little chip in there and see. It will be ketchup. May Allah forgive us. I hope you understand my example. What I'm saying is, you don't always believe everything around you. If it does not concern you, leave it. If it concerns you, the good, you believe. The bad, you need evidence that is convincing, compelling, without a doubt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us strength. Say Ameen.
Ameen.
Okay, let's move on. Can we move further? Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam, during his time in the jail, he had 2-3 people in the prison with him. He told them about Allah. He was with them in the jail. What did he say? Ya sahibi s-sijni arbabun متفرقون خير أم الله الواحد القهار. Oh my companions of this jail cell, is it better to worship the one who made you alone, or is it better to worship so many gods and deities besides him? The question, what was he doing? He was giving them da'wah. He was propagating to them the true belief in Allah and Allah alone. To worship your maker alone, that is what he was propagating. So what do I learn from that? You can write it down. Seize every opportunity to call people towards goodness. Seize every opportunity to call people towards goodness. You are in your classroom, you are at a football match, you are gone to some party, you might be perhaps at some event. You might also be seated here today. Seize the opportunity to talk to your friends about something good. Don't talk about something bad. When we get together, we only ask people the bad questions sometimes, the dirty questions sometimes. When you get together with your friends, what do you discuss? You discuss, did you watch that movie? Oh, did you see this? Did you play that game? Did you see this car? Do you see that girl? Did you see what she did? Did you hear the latest gossip? Do you know what this person did? All of that is not beneficial. But talk about Allah and His Rasul. Can you read Surah Al-Ikhlas? Do you know the meaning of Ayatul Kursi? Do you understand what is Mu'awwidhat? Do you know what you are supposed to be doing as a Muslim? These type of questions are very beneficial. So when you meet each other, when you gather together, when you are sitting together, talk about something constructive. You can even talk about mathematics and science and biology and English. You can, or any other subject that is beneficial. It does not necessarily have to be something to do with your religion alone. No, but it must be something beneficial, not destructive. You don't come together and just talk about things that are destructive. Look at Yusuf alayhi salam. He's in the jail. If he wanted, he could have just played cards and drafts and everything else, some games of chess and whatnot, and waste time and spend time and say, we don't know, we've got to kill time. They use the word killing time, isn't it? We are going to kill time. No, you don't kill time, you utilize it. You use the time. You use the time constructively. You make sure that when you have an opportunity given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you make use of it. You make use of the time given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a very constructive way. So you talk to people, you can sit down. Right guys, we have a mathematics exam in 2 months' time. Let's try and do some mathematical perhaps questions. Let's try and answer some questions on algebra or whatever else you are learning. And you start asking each other, you study together. When you study together, you would be able to pass your exam, inshallah, with flying colors. It's easier to study in a group than it is individually for most people. Some people like to study all on their own, but with some, if I ask you, you answer, you ask me, I answer, etc., etc., it makes it easier to study. It makes it easy. We read a passage, you start asking questions of comprehension, I ask questions, etc. And this is what helps us sometimes. So, the point I'm raising is, we learn from Yusuf alayhi salam's session that he had with the prisoners, that we should be from those who utilize opportunities. Use the opportunity. He was not going to meet those men again. He used the opportunity. However, when he told one of the men to remember him, when he went out, that look, there is an innocent man in the jail, Allah made, or should I say Shaytan made, that man forget Yusuf alayhi salam. Until one day the king saw a dream. Okay, the king saw a dream. I'm not going to ask you what was the dream, because I presume some of you might know the dream. If you know the dream of that king, even if you know it roughly, what it was, maybe a little bit you might know, put up your hand, I want to see what the dream of the king was. You might know it. Okay. I want you to say loudly, what was the number of cows that he saw?
Seven.
Wow, that means we really know it. Okay. I'm glad you know this, because one of the reasons is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us see dreams. Every dream that you see has... I think I should stop. We are not concentrating anymore. We are busy watching the actors who are acting here. Can I go away? I think I will.
Subhanallah. Okay, I won't. I give you another chance, inshallah. Right? Or are you giving me another chance? Okay, either way. So Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam, when the king saw the dream, there is a point we need to learn. And that is, how many of us dream? Put up your hands. We dream at night, isn't it? Put your hands down. How many of you do not see dreams? Put up your hands. Yes, there are a few. I know that. You say, we don't see dreams. Put your hands down. Inshallah, you will start seeing a dream. You see, near your ear, there is a knob. You look for it. You need to turn the frequency at night. Make sure that you get to 94.2. Then you will see the dreams. If it is 94.1, 94.3, you won't see the dream. So at night, you just play with your ear a little bit. You twist it this way, that way. And you get to the correct channel. Then you sleep. You'll see your dream, inshallah. Is that correct? No, it's just a joke. You guys are already playing with your ears. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. I'm just joking with you to draw your attention. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. Ameen, ameen, ameen. Okay, when you see a dream, it is not always filled with meaning. A dream is normally just something that people have not yet been able to pinpoint. But sometimes you were thinking of something. Sometimes subconsciously you don't realize a thought went through your mind. Sometimes you might not realize you saw something. Sometimes you fear something. And sometimes it's just abstract. You haven't thought of it, but it happened. Sometimes you fly in your dreams like a bird. How many of you fly sometimes in your dream? You go high and you just start flying like a bird. Shoo. You can go all the way up, fly from Abuja to Maiduguri and wherever else, and you come back and you're so happy. MashaAllah. And sometimes in real life you want to try it, right? So you start flapping your hands and guess what? You don't even move from your house, from your bed, up to the bathroom. So remember, it's just a dream. Not all dreams have meanings, but if you see a dream and it stays with you and it repeats itself sometimes and it just doesn't leave your mind, perhaps there is a chance that that dream might have a good meaning or a reminder for you to do something or to become closer to Allah or to protect yourself from shaitan or from evil. So sometimes you see a dream, it makes you scared. You get up, you are taught to say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim, right? I seek Allah's protection from shaitan the accursed. And sometimes what happens, we are actually taught to give a charity. We are taught to seek the help of Allah, to turn the other way and sleep. Sometimes to spit on the left side thrice in a spittoon, not just on the floor. You don't just start spitting on the floor and say, I saw a bad dream. You miss the whole floor. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Then you might want to ask someone what the meaning of that dream is. If you think about it a lot, subhanAllah, sorry I'm being distracted by these two uncles who are here. We will not forgive them, inshallah. We're not going to forgive them. They should have been here way before I was here, but they were not. So the fault is theirs. May Allah forgive you, not us. You are disturbing these children, my beloved brothers. You could have waited until I finished and then came. So, sorry, it takes away my concentration and yours too, doesn't it? Everyone was looking at them because they were acting in the movies that they are trying to make. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy. I'm glad because it's going to go down in history. A few minutes time, I'm going to put this talk up online and this speech will be there. So people know next time, don't mess. Right? Don't mess. May Allah bless you all. So when the king saw a dream, and I need to end, I've got 2 more minutes remaining or 1.5 minutes. But we will go into injury time because people have distracted us, right? We can go into injury time until we hear the final whistle being blown by the referee who is sitting on the side there. So Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam, like I said, when the dream was seen, that man remembered him and told that king that there is someone who can help you interpret the dream. So they brought the professional from the prison to come to interpret the dream. When the dream was interpreted, and I'm cutting it short, subhanallah, the king was so impressed with the honesty, integrity of this young man that he clarified the name of the man to say, you know what, you were not guilty. And the evidence was never against you, but it was the plot against you that made it seem that you were guilty, but you were not guilty.
From this I learned something. When you are accused and you are innocent, a day will come when Allah will make it clear that you were innocent. Even if it takes long, even if it takes 10 years or more. When you are accused of something that you are innocent of, it's a sign of the love of Allah, because it happened to those who were better than you and I. When you are accused of something you are innocent of, a day will come when Allah will clarify your name. A day will come when you will be given an opportunity to smile. A day will come when Allah will give you that chance to shine once again. Look at Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So don't become depressed. People accuse you of doing something you did not do. Yes, try to clarify your name, but if you are accused in a very big way, hand it over to Allah. And say, oh Allah, help me. Oh Allah, grant me goodness, protect me. Grant me the ability to clarify my good name. And oh Allah, protect me at all times. These type of supplications are very, very important. Now I want to fast forward to the end. At the end of this beautiful story, do you know what happened? There was something known as forgiveness that took place. Without that forgiveness, the brothers were not going to come together again. Sometimes we have problems with our friends, with our family members. Remember, learn to forgive. Keep forgiving. Someone asks, how many times should I forgive? There is no limit to it. There is no limit to it. Yes, if someone is really harming you, you might want to stay away from them. Don't hold it in your heart. Your heart is too clean. There is so much space in your heart. You cannot allow that space to be occupied by bad things, negative things, hatred, ill feeling, and so on. Let that space be occupied by the best of feelings. So I don't have a space in my heart for hatred, for jealousy, for envy, for problems, for negativity. Because my heart, I need it to be good and clean. I need it to be pure. It only has a certain capacity. If I fill it with these negative things, I become a person who's always sad, who only says bad words, who's always angry, upset, who looks at things and thinks the worst of what he has seen or she has seen. No, I want to be good. When I see something, I want to smile. I want to be able to think of the good, even if I see something that might appear negative. This is what I learned. I need to forgive. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was now in a very high position, and his brothers came in front of him and they were asking for food, basic food. And so Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam decided to ask them a question. What was the question? هَلْ عَلِمْتُمْ مَا فَعَلْتُمْ بِيُوسُفَ وَأَخِيهِ إِذْ أَنْتُمْ جَاهِلُونَ. Do you know what you did to Yusuf and his brother when you were ignorant? They were shocked, because no one knew about Yusuf. They said, is it possible you are Yusuf? He says, yes, I am Yusuf. This is my brother. Allah has favored us. Allah gave us a gift. He didn't say, I am Yusuf, this is my brother, all of you are going to jail, I'm going to punish you, beat you up, I'm going to make sure you are executed. He could have done that, right? He could have, but he didn't. He said, no, I'm going to forgive you today. Allah has already elevated us above. Allah has favored us. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favor every one of us. When you learn to forgive people and you have a good heart, Allah will raise your status very, very high. Allah will raise your status very high. Why? Because it is not easy to forgive. It is not easy to forgive. Imagine someone did something bad to you. Are you ready to forgive them? In many cases, I don't know. I can't. They are very bad. That's what we say, right? But Allah says, if you are going to forgive, I will forgive you. I will forgive you. Because what you have done is very, very high and noble. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. So that is why these two brothers who are here, we forgive them. Halas. Moments ago I said we won't forgive them, isn't it? But we learn from the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, it's a minor matter, it's a small. We love them, they are doing it for our good as well. It's only that maybe we didn't agree with the timing, but so what, big deal. It's okay, we forgive them and we ask them also to forgive us, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum, jazakumullah khair. Does anyone have a question before I leave? Anyone? Question related to the topic? One question there in the center. Yes.
alaykum.
Wa alaykum salam. Wa
rahmatullah. Now, what are the names of the people that Yusuf alayhi salam told him about Allah in prison?
Okay, Jazakumullah khair. The question is, what are the names of the people whom Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam told them about Allah in the prison? And the correct answer is, I do not know. Alhamdulillah. That is the correct answer. I do not know the names. And I can tell you something else. Even if there are names, sometimes they are from narrations that may not even be valid. The relevance is that the names are not as important as the lesson that is learned from that particular incident. So, myself, it doesn't mean just because I'm a scholar, I will know the answer of everything. You heard me say, I don't know. I don't know. It's a true answer. So, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. I have not seen it in the Quran nor in the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It might be mentioned in some Israeliyat, but really I cannot confirm that for you. Jazakumullah khair. I will take one that is written after I take one from here. The sister at the back there, the one at the back with the black scarf and the green, a young girl, maybe she looks 10 years old or 9, the one behind this, the girl with the red, the one behind the girl with the red scarf. The one behind the girl with the red scarf, yes. Salam. Okay, very interesting. You people are asking me names, mashallah, names. I know when I came to Nigeria, wallahi, I was impressed. You know why? Because every sister, her name is Khadijatu, Fatimatu, Aishatu, Zainab, and Ruqayya, and so on and so forth. These names are the most common names in Nigeria. Am I right?
Yes.
Subhanallah. So, I was so impressed. I said, you know, back where I come from and in the rest of the world, they think of exotic names that have never been heard before. And here in Nigeria, the names of the daughters and wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahabiyat, those are the only ones that have chosen. I know a family here in Nigeria. There are so many Maryams, you get confused in the same family. And so many Khadijas and so many Aminas. And so many, and mashallah, every other person you ask, your name, Khadija. Your name, Saadiyah. Your name, Fatima, your name Zainab, your name Aisha. MashaAllah, Tabarakallah. However, getting back to the names of the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam, the one that is made mention of is Binyamin. He is the one out of those 11 whom they say shared same mother, same father. But the others, I have to give you the same answer which is correct. I have to give you the same answer which is correct that I gave the brother earlier. I do not know. And you know what? They are mentioned. They are there. I don't know them off by heart. But we don't know if those narrations are actually correct or not. Because again, it is irrelevant to know the names. Now I can tell you something very interesting. In the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when people are known for something very good, a lot of the times the name is mentioned. But when there is an example of something negative, a lot of the times the name is not mentioned, so you won't know. I want to give you one example before I take the last question which will be written. The example of a Bedouin man who came into the masjid and urinated. Have you heard that story?
Yes.
What was his name? No ways. It will not be mentioned. Why? Because it was something negative. Imagine they knew your name. That this man, his name was so and so, he came into the masjid, he urinated. People won't even want to use that name again yet. It might be a good name, subhanallah. So this is the beauty of Islam, the beauty of revelation. That when there is something negative, mostly the name is not mentioned. Not always, but mostly the name is not mentioned. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Can I see the questions here and perhaps take one of them?
Okay.
Or if you have chosen one, you can read it out for me. Yes.
A brother or sister asked, they say patience is key. When you have been patient for long, you don't enjoy life because you have been patient. Then you die with your patience. What do you do?
I think the question is about patience and endurance. You need to know something. Patience is an act of worship that cannot be fulfilled except by a person going through negativity. Do you agree? If everything is smooth, can you engage in the ibadah known as sabr? Can you say, I'm just doing sabr, but nothing is wrong in your life. I'm doing sabr, I'm bearing patience. Well, bearing patience about what? Everything is there in your life. So Allah says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Indeed, Allah grants the recompense for those who bear patience without limit. Without limit. There is no limit for the reward. You must bear patience. And bearing patience is an act of worship that is only given to those who go through turbulent times, negativity, sadness, loss, etc. And this is why there are many verses in the Quran similar to this, where Allah speaks about sabr and patience. We will continue bearing patience until we meet with Allah. Because ultimately, when we get Jannatul Firdaus, when we get paradise, we will be able to say, Subhanallah, look at the reward for all the patience I endured. But shaitan comes to you and says, no, you better give up. You better give up. So now you say, I want to give up. I want to do this. I want to do that. No, no, no. We don't want to give up. And we don't want shaitan to have the upper hand. Never. We always need to be from those who bear patience in a beautiful way, such that we feel the blessings of Allah through the turbulent times that we go through. And this is why Allah keeps saying that, you know what? The reward of those who bear patience is unlimited. And it's from me. And Allah says, I am close to those who bear patience. So inshallah, we will keep on enduring for the sake of Allah. And we will find the sweetness in this endurance and patience. And we will continue to ask Allah to help us. And who knows, Allah might grant you ease in the world. But when you have one problem and it's resolved, Allah puts another one in your life. And then it's resolved and Allah puts a third one in your life. That is the nature of this life. Because when you have one examination and you pass it, do you just sit at home? You still keep on going to school. You get another exam. You pass that one. You get a third exam. Each time you pass the exam, what happens to your level? It keeps going higher. If you pass grade 1, you go to grade 2. You pass grade 2, what grade do you go to? From 3 you go to? 4 you go to? And so on. Until you have had 30, 40 examinations and finally you graduate from university and you are now a top-notch person who has qualified. The same applies to life. One problem, you graduate, you go to another one. It might be bigger. You go to a third one. So don't think that a time will come in your life when you have no problems at all. Because if that's the case, perhaps Allah does not love you. Like Allah says through the blessed lips of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I mentioned the hadith already, when Allah loves you, He tests you. Because He wants you to go higher and higher, become more and more closer to Allah until you meet with Him in a condition that you are closest compared to what you were in the past. May Allah bless you all. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.